Welcome to Nobody Told Me. I'm Laura Owens.
And I'm Jan Black. A lot of people dream of working for a high-tech startup. But how do you make that dream become a reality? Stephen Mark Kahan knows how to do just that, and he shares his wisdom in the new book, Be a Startup Superstar. Ignite your career working at a tech startup.
Steve is our guest on this episode, and one of his passions these days is to teach those graduating from college and those who'd like to switch careers how to earn a great living at a tech startup. Steve, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you. I have been very much looking forward to being on your show.
Well, we can't wait to hear your wisdom. You've successfully helped to grow 7 startup companies from early stage development to going public or being sold. How did you get to do that? We'd love to hear more about your background.
That is correct, but my background didn't start that way, that's for sure. I actually did not start in the startup world. I actually started at a large corporation, and what I found was the traditional path of school to climbing the corporate ladder could not only be high risk for my career, it almost felt like a death trap. And my father is like so many other fathers and mothers. I remember my father just pounding into me as I was growing up. He would say, Steve, get your degree, go to work for a large corporation, you work hard, they'll take care of you, and you will have a great career.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, he also used to say, except your mother and I would much prefer that you become a doctor or a lawyer, but getting a job at a large corporation will do. So that's what I did. And so I graduated college, and I went to work at a large corporation. And I remember about a year and a half in, I opened up my bank statement and I was down to $50 in my bank account. And I was staring at the pile of claims I was supposed to process that day, wondering how on earth I'll ever get ahead. And I'd worked long days, and the student loans used to take a hold of my paycheck before it ever had a chance to hit my bank account. And so I asked myself a question early on. I said, how do I earn a great living doing what I love? And I knew that the traditional route and working at a large corporation just wouldn't be that. And so I made all the mistakes in the world, of which I've certainly learned how to pick a good startup now, but started applying at some startups in the local area, and was fortunate enough to get a job. And 3 years later, that company, I was the first person hired in marketing, and that company went public, and I got the bug and never left the startup world. And as you've mentioned, now I'm with my 7th startup.
What is it that excites you about the culture of startup companies compared with your traditional big corporations?
So I guess maybe that you almost have to take a step back to define what a startup actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And to answer that, so according to the United States Small Business Administration, a startup's a company that's been in business for under a year and is in the formative stages. But that actually paints a poor picture, in my view, for what defines a startup. And my friend Doug Irwin, who's chairman of a venture capital company and serial entrepreneur, he says that a startup is a company that operates like it's the last frontier for outlaws, a place where nonconformists can live, create, and sell their ideas. And to me, that's really cool. Who doesn't want to be involved in that? Because you get to be the rough-riding rebel running circles around slow-moving bureaucratic corporations. So you're right. A startup is a culture. It's a mindset. It's a team of crazies hell-bent on changing the world. And when you contrast that versus like a traditional large corporation, you'll often find, as I did, that they tend to be burdened with incumbent mindsets. You're hired for a very specific, oftentimes pigeonholed, smaller role. Barrier to advancement could be higher. And these larger corporations, they're like giant ships. They're hard to maneuver. They're slow to change course. There tends to be more acceptance of the bureaucracy or the status quo, and contrast that versus a startup, which darts around those giant ships like speedboats. There oftentimes is more innovation. They move fast. They're known as nimble, almost like a startup mentality. And so to me, it's really a culture. It's a mindset. It is that smaller team of crazies who just believe that they're onto something and they can make a dent in the world in which we live in. And when you have that comparison versus some of the traditional larger corporations and you're entrepreneurial, that's an environment for sure for you.
You have so many who are so wickedly smart and who have just come from top schools. They're working 24/7, and yet they're not seeing success. Why do you think that is? Why do some startup founders succeed while others don't, even if both of them have good ideas?
You know, first of all, you know, look at some of the people that you know, even looking at the opportunities within startups first, is that, you know, you'll find that you'll never see a startup, for example, I'm with a cybersecurity startup that's gone from $8 million to $100 million in less than 4 years right now, and we're just high-flying. And yet, we'll never really be, and we're corporately located in Washington, D.C., you're not going to find us in Lawrence, Kansas, for example, at a recruiting event at a college campus. And so when I talked to my friend, Josiah Sunfeld, who's a professor at the University of Texas McCombs School of Business, he asked his students where they plan to work when they graduate. And most of his students will say that they'll go to work for a large Fortune 500 corporation. So oftentimes, students, first and foremost, they when they think of startups, they think of startups that they would need to start themselves, not necessarily the 46,000 venture-backed startups that exist around the United States, some of which, many of which, are great companies where they can move into. And so I think that's one end of the spectrum that people oftentimes going to college don't think startups first. And then when you look at, you know, what separates CEOs that might be successful at a startup organization versus, you know, a large organization, I think it comes on with a mindset. And because when you're with a startup or you're a CEO as a startup, you are going to be dealing with major obstacles. You are going to be going against big companies who have all the advantages. They have all seemingly tremendous amount of funding, resources. You'll never be able to outspend them. You won't have more people than them. But these are people that oftentimes don't get dissuaded by that. They often view that if there is a lack of competition, it might actually show that there's a lack of a market. They're the types of folks that say, bring it on. And they believe that they can win in spite of all the odds in front of them. And so I think that one of the biggest characteristics that you'll find that separates these people, particularly who are successful, are things like persistence, tenacity, and just self-belief that they absolutely are on the right track and that they can win. And I found that the startup executives who tend to have more success have some of those attributes.
Your new book is called Be a Startup Superstar, Ignite Your Career Working at a Tech Startup. I'm wondering, what is the purpose of the book? Why did you decide to write it?
So I decided to write the book. Ultimately, when I got started, it's kind of interesting in that I never really thought that I would write a book, right? And so there have been a number of people over the years that have asked me to mentor them. I also have two young professionals that are my children. And I wanted to write the book for those that are on my team or those that I mentor or my kids, quite frankly. And so I really went about putting together what I just consider to be manuscript at first for them and to help them and to try to not only do things, for example, why work at a startup versus a large corporation? How do you find and land a job at the best startup company? And then also what I characterized as 7 keys to the C-suite, 35 actions, attitudes, and behaviors that I've learned by working with hundreds of amazingly smart and talented startup entrepreneurs that one must possess to achieve success. So really what I wanted to do was to write a book that is filled with actionable how-to information that was a quick read that would help those closest to me to learn from what I've learned, and so they can be successful in their careers. Little did I know that there would be a great deal of interest beyond those original people who I wrote it for, and that I would have offers from what ultimately was five publishers within a year of just coming up with the idea to get the book out. So it was a lot of fun, but that's kind of the reason, really, to help people in their careers.
I love how you talk about leaders and what separates the good ones from the not so good ones. And I'm curious to know what qualities you found that seem to be pretty uniform in every great leader that you've worked with.
That's a great question. And so here's how I see it. And I'm just going to list what they are in my view. So I think, first of all, it's people who embrace accountability to get things done. Secondly, people who communicate in thoughtful, smart, confident, and respectful ways. These things catch my eye. People who ask maybe sometimes more questions than simply just talking. People who are not I people, meaning that they're kind of self-proud and they take all the credit, but they're we people who really focus on building an aligned team, and focusing on the team, and sharing the credit every step along the way. People who are prepared to work hard. There just is, I wish there were an easy button, but there just isn't. People who pay attention to the details, right? And so who see the big picture, but you know, oftentimes success comes down to managing some of those details. You know, I mentioned persistence and tenacity, which is key. But then also people who are, no matter where they are in their career, that they themselves have mentors. And that there's this hunger for learning more, knowing that in really any field, especially in this constantly changing environment in which we are in, that you can never know enough. You can never stay on top of things at the pace of change. And so folks who are willing learners that don't wait for someone to create a career training program for them, that they go out and create it for themselves. And so those are the characteristics as I see it.
So what are the tech startups looking for in terms of the people they hire? Do you have to have a tech background, for example? And do you have to be in your 20s or 30s?
So the answer is absolutely not. So this is the amazing thing, is that there was a recent study of startup CEOs, and the question that was posed was, what's the number one issue keeping them up at night? And the response to that question was hiring good people. Now think of that. Mm-hmm. Hiring good people was rated ahead of growing revenue, acquiring customers, or gaining access to more capital. And they're hiring people across all functional disciplines, sales, marketing, HR, finance. And if you look at, and they're desperate to hire, right? And so what you'll find is that startups, because they don't have the wherewithal or the capital to go and do major recruiting, are absolutely desperate. In the case of the cybersecurity industry, there's predicted to be by 2022, a 1 million shortage in jobs by 22. And so there's just a huge gap, and so there's huge opportunity, and they are looking for people who are young, old, experienced, green, those who work in the office or remote, and so there is a tremendous opportunities right now to go to work for great startups.
What do you think is really lacking in a lot of the cultures that startups seem to have trouble reaching everybody?
I think part of what's lacking, outside of some of the obvious of not having maybe some of the financial resources to go out and do more consistent recruiting across the United States, I think is a perception that I consider to be kind of a false perception of startups. And that is that startups often require long hours. I mean, so do a lot of companies, but startups in particular, because there's not a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's kind of a perception that, you know, how can you really succeed without burning out? And gee, if I go to work at a startup, it could be risky, or, you know, maybe I'll have poor work-life balance. And so on the one hand, you have to learn how to, some of the criteria to select a good startup versus a startup that, could really be a great startup, of which, you know, I've formulated some ideas on. But then also just sort of succeeding with respect to burnout at startups. And I mentioned that I think it's sort of maybe an unfair perception of startups to some extent. And what I've learned over the years, because I'm sort of a workaholic that has made time for family events, kids' games, certainly my wife and so on. And what I've learned is this. First of all, is that I think the term work-life balance, I almost don't even like it. I heard the other day a term called work-life harmony, and I really liked that better because I felt that it's actually a sliding scale. Work-life balance suggests that there's a perfect answer, there's a right answer, therefore sometimes people always feel out of balance. Mm-hmm. And I don't feel that that's almost setting too high a bar. And then I've also found that that you've got to be your own top priority, and people struggle with this, that the most important item on your calendar is you. And so I'd like to challenge your listeners right now and ask them, do they have a calendar that reflects this? And so go ahead and open your calendar right now and check to see how many appointments you have with yourself this week or next week. And I'll bet you that there's too few. And, you know, you think about the most valuable uses of your time and, you know, whether that's creating unnecessary meetings or blocking off the time you need to take care of yourself and your family. And I personally look at my calendar at least 2 weeks in advance, sometimes more, and block out time for myself, whether that's family time, learning time, time that I'm going to focus on strategy, time where I want to work out, and really then defend that calendar. And so if you put your family first, if you be your own top priority, I think that work-life harmony really could be managed big time. And that there's sort of a false perception that you're going to have to work consistent 12, 15-hour days. And you know, there's no question. There may be some of those. But it's not every single day, right? And so it's the work will ebb and flow, and there will be those crunch time periods and that one would need to accept. But just as many crunch time periods, there are the opposite of that. And so I think in part that you've really got to learn how to manage your calendar, and quite frankly, that some of that perception of a startup, you know, just being maybe too much for many people is more perception than reality.
If someone is listening to this and maybe they're a recent college graduate or they're someone who's been in the work world for a while and they think, gee, I'd really like to give it a go at a high-tech startup, what advice would you have for them in terms of finding the right opportunity in a startup, just finding a startup that stands maybe a better chance of succeeding than one that is doomed to failure?
Right. So let me answer both of those questions. So first of all, how do you select a startup? You know, some startups have good stories and some startups have both a good story as well as a good chance for success. So if I would have been with one or maybe even two successful startups that had really good exits, then maybe I would be lucky. but six going on seven, right? So there's a few things that I've learned. So the first thing and criteria just in terms of selecting a startup is basically, are there quality people that share your values, right? And so you are going to be working with a small team of people that that you're going to be working really closely with. In many ways, these are almost like extended family. And so you're going to be spending a lot of time with them. And so you want to make sure that that the startup has those quality people that share your values. And there's questions that you can ask when you're meeting with them to determine if, in fact, that is actually the case. And, you know, if you read the mission statements, you ask questions to understand what are the values of the people that you're meeting with, you could really sort of smoke that out very quickly. Secondly, does the concept of that start a big market need? And so what I've certainly learned is, particularly from a business-to-business technology startup or many other startups, that buyers don't spend money on nice-to-solve problems. They spend money on must-solve problems. And so, you know, through simple Googling and reading what the influencers and the analysts have to say, you can really learn if that company is filling a big market need. And then, again, how it is set apart from its competitors. And again, we'll say, don't worry if there is competition. Worry if there's no competition, because competition means that there's a market. The third criteria that I often look at, once I've found that it does serve a big market need, there are quality people that share its values, is the product one that I can actually believe in myself? Right. And so, you know, you really need to believe in it. You know, would you purchase or use it or recommend it? And so you won't be able to get behind the product with enthusiasm if you don't yourself have that belief. And then finally, is the startup well-funded? So naturally, you want to choose a startup that has a long enough runway to get off the ground. And you want to check in that it's properly capitalized so you have the best chance for growth and stability. So those are some of the criteria that I look at.
Where do you suggest that people look for these startups? Is there a good website?
There are two really underutilized ways to find these jobs. So first of all, in virtually every major city around the United States, if you just get on Google and you Google technology or business accelerators, often known as seed accelerators, in, say, Austin, Texas, as an example. These are oftentimes application-only programs that provide capital, mentorship, and educational opportunities to startups. And oftentimes, their companies that work with these accelerators post jobs right on the accelerator websites themselves. And these are jobs that you won't find posted elsewhere, right? And so they're part of the accelerator, they'll post the jobs, and it's sort of almost a hidden secret. There are thousands of jobs posted on these accelerator websites right now, virtually in every functional area in major cities across the United States. And then the second thing that I would really suggest that your listeners go do is really what people have done with me. And that is go to the hiring director, the hiring managers directly. So, for example, there are people that have contacted me and engaged me online via social media, maybe things like LinkedIn, where they may have read some of my posts, they see some of the things that I'm posting as an example, and then they reach out in a very sincere, very kind of specialized private connection and engage with you to basically provide them guidance in their career, because they oftentimes will reach out and ask for it directly. And most executives at startups like myself, and there are many others that I know, we've all been helped along the way in our careers. And so we want to give back too and pay it forward. And so those that have reached out to me very personally, and by the way, you're reaching out to busy people, so don't get discouraged if you don't get a ton of responses, but you will get responses. And when you're able to engage with those leaders, then obviously the conversation's going to then get back over to you where you are within your particular situation, whether you're graduating college, whether you already started in your career, and you get a chance to talk about yourself. And because startups are desperate for hiring, I've oftentimes had some of those conversations and said, gee, this is someone we need to bring in here. And so you can kind of avoid HRs, your red tape, that sort of thing occasionally. And you're going right directly to the hiring manager. And there probably isn't enough of that. Now, I highly recommend that your listeners give that a try.
Steve, our show is called Nobody Told Me, and we always ask our guests, what is your Nobody Told Me lesson? So what is it that you have learned over the years with regard to startups and working for them that was maybe a hard lesson to learn and you kind of wish someone had told you before?
There's a couple. I think in startups, you know, it's all about, to some extent, bucking the conventional wisdom and maybe taking the world on a new path. Perhaps it's a new path that they had never considered. And so we've all heard the sayings, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, or that's the way we've always done things around here. And the status quo is strong because it represents a bias that can permeate the culture of a company for keeping in place the current state of affairs. It's comfortable, it's predictable, it's perceived as less risky, but growth requires change. And so most every person in an organization that wants to become great at some point had to challenge the status quo. And so I guess maybe one item I would say is to regularly challenge the status quo. And then along with that, to make sure that you summon the courage to make the tough decisions. You've got to have, do you have the guts to make an unpopular decision? You know, strong leaders are able to quickly assess a situation and decide when others stand idle. And don't be afraid about making the wrong decision, because the world doesn't exist in black and white. It exists in shades and gray. And so worst case, the most difficult part of making the decision is having the courage to know that you might be wrong when the outcome is unclear, but you decide anyways. Those are two bits of advice I would offer.
Those are fantastic. That applies to so many different things, yeah. Not just related to the startup world, but just in general. And Steve, how can people connect with you on social media and learn more about the book and your blog post?
You're welcome to contact me directly or learn more about my book by going to www.beastartupsuperstar.com. And I look forward to speaking with you or hearing what you think about the book should you decide to go ahead and read it.
Steve, we thank you so much for joining us. This has been very enlightening.
Thank you for having me.
Our thanks to Steve and Mark Kahan, author of the new book, Be a Startup Superstar, Ignite Your Career Working at a Tech Startup. And again, his website is beastartupsuperstar.com. I'm Jan Black.
And I'm Laura Owens.
You're listening to Nobody Told Me. Thank you so much for joining us.